I wanted to make a list of queens that I think we all should be aware of as Afro-descended people. I'm hoping it can be a sort of model or standard when considering great African queens. Popular culture has a tendency to pick historical figures and promote them frequently through all available mediums, whether it be education or entertainment. And so, I want the queens on this list to inspire us and our children in a similar way. What up, African world? It's Home Team here, and welcome back to another video of African history, culture, and worldview. By supporting this channel on Patreon, you're helping in the creation of these videos and supporting this content. If you'd like access to full courses and sources, or you simply want to show your support, you may do so by clicking the Patreon link in the description box below. There were many queens on the continent of Africa, some gaining more attention than others. However, when we talk about them in classrooms or social media, I'd like for us to have our own standard list of exceptional African queens, a list that we may point to as an example and be proud of. Oftentimes, when I hear about African queens, it's the same rulers being highlighted, and admittedly, I'm guilty of that myself. But it's not that repetition is a bad thing when it comes to our history. I just want to point to some other great queens that should roll off our tongue just as much. So today, I'll be speaking about 10 African queens, three of which may be new to some of you. So let's begin. I'll start with a queen from Senegal that we often don't hear much about. Queen Ndata Yala was a queen of Wallo in 19th century Senegal. She played a crucial role during colonialism in her struggle against the French. The Kingdom of Wallo was trying to maintain its assets against the French on St. Louis Island and against other African kingdoms. The French were reliant on the Kingdom of Wallo to get goods into the island because the products had to pass through the Queen's lands. The French asked the Queen to stop the taxes and protested its very existence. She responded accordingly. "We have wronged no one because the country belongs to us and we must govern it. It is we who guarantee the passage of livestock in our country. For this reason, we will take a tenth and will never accept otherwise." Queen Ndata Yala stood her ground against the growing threat of the French and other Africans further north. As relations became sour, she pillaged in the French-held territories and war became inevitable. She refused to compensate the French upon their request and stop trade. She understood the temperature of the time and would not allow any deception or appeasement. After months of battle, the Queen refused to surrender. Even after defeat, she still tried to rally the troops and fought bravely until the very end. She made it her mission to reject everything the French wanted to implement in her kingdom that she believed was not in the best interests of her people, and for this sacrifice, she should be remembered. Next, we have Mwana Mkisi. Queen Mwana Mkisi is of great importance to the Swahili community in Mombasa, Kenya. We don't know an exact date for her existence, but she is believed to have existed before the arrival of Islam in that region of East Africa. Queen Mwana is said to be the mother of the Thanashara Taifa, also known as the 12 Swahili tribes of Mombasa. She's an exceptional queen because she's considered by many to be the founder of Mombasa. According to oral accounts, the original name of Mombasa was called Kangowea, or Gangwa, and then Mvita. Mvita meaning place of war. This name exemplifies the history of Mombasa, which was constantly fought over. The oldest known written mention of Kangowea and the queen is from a poem by Mombasa's most famous Swahili poet named Bwana Muyaka, who lived during the 19th century. Bwana no doubt took from earlier oral sources. Here's what he has to say. "Kangowea belongs to Mwana Mkisi. Mvita is the ancient city. Do not exceed its bounds, but tread respectfully therein. Cast down your head, and do not look straight with your eyes wide open. It is an abyss of deep gloom. Even those who are well informed comprehend it not." Queen Mwana Mkisi is exceptional because the local people consider her to be the founder of the first urban civilization in the region, this settlement being the center of power for the Thanashara Taifa. In many ways, insistence on remembering Queen Mwana Mkisi through oral and written transliteration symbolizes how the local people tried to keep their identity despite the intrusion of foreign influences and the erasure of local tradition. I think if the Swahili people felt the need to remember her, we should remember her as well. Next, we have Queen Idia of the 16th century. Queen Idia was the mother of Oba Asigi of the Benin Empire. She was technically a queen mother, but she held considerable power and influence. Her exploits no doubt shaped the future of Benin. During her time, Benin was in a state of crisis and civil unrest. The Igala people attempted to take advantage of this, but eventually, Oba Asigi was able to control the situation by defeating them and his rivals of the Benin throne. Queen Idia is believed to have raised an army for her son to fight off the rival to the throne. She accomplished this and many other things. This success led Asigi to credit his mother for his victory, and so he created the title Ioba, or Queen Mother, giving her significant political power, which in all honesty, she probably already possessed, he just made it official. Queen Mother Idia is an exceptional African queen because she very clearly was able to assess the situation around her and position herself and others to positions of power. That kind of political acumen is an invaluable resource and a great model for us today. Next, we have Ya Asantewaa from the Kingdom of Ashanti in the 19th century, and like Queen Idia of Benin, she was also a queen mother. Ya Asantewaa is well known in the diaspora for being the leading figure in the War of the Golden Stool against the British. Much of the literature on Ya Asantewaa concerns itself with this war. Although we are not sure about every detail concerning her involvement, Ya Asantewaa is acknowledged as the crowning patriotic figure who led the resistance. Her name is celebrated throughout the diaspora for her bravery. The British wanted to symbolically trample over the Ashanti by demanding the golden stool. Ya Asantewaa's charge to protect the stool was heard, and ultimately, the goal of protecting the soul of the Ashanti in the form of the golden stool was successful. This symbolic victory came at a price as Ya Asantewaa was exiled to Seychelles, but her memory has never been exiled from our minds. Next, we have Queen Amina of the Hausa people. Most of what is known about Queen Amina comes from Hausa oral tradition and the Kano Chronicle, a history of the Hausa state of Kano written in the 19th century. Recent investigations into the history of Queen Amina claim that she most probably lived in the 15th century or earlier. According to oral tradition, Queen Amina expanded the empire of Zaria in northern Nigeria, which included kingdoms such as the Nupe and Kororofa. She also extended her influence over Kano and Katsina. At this time, Zaria, under Queen Amina, conquered all the towns as far as Kwarafara and Nupe. Every town paid tribute to her. The Sarakin Nupe sent 40 eunuchs and 10,000 kolas to her. She was the first to have eunuchs and kolas in Hausa land. In other words, she's considered a conqueror queen among the greatest of West Africa. Some even credit her for constructing earthen walls around her cities. It was under her rule that the state of Zaria became the most powerful in all of Hausa land. Next, we have Queen Gudi of Ethiopia. Queen Gudi is known by several names such as Yodith, Judith, and Esato. She was an Ethiopian queen believed to have existed around 970 AD. According to the Encyclopedia of African History and Culture, very little is known about Queen Gudi beyond scattered references in ancient texts and oral history. Most believe that she was vehemently opposed to the Monophysite beliefs of the Ethiopian Christian Church at the time, and designed a plan to utterly destroy the Aksumite Empire in the 10th century. Her armies razed churches and destroyed the countryside. Some believe that she was an Algol-speaking woman from the southwest region, and also, some believe that she alone ushered in the new Zagwe dynasty as her exploits left Aksum weak. Following the destruction of Aksum, Queen Gudi is said to have maintained a 40-year rule over a region historians believe may actually have been Aksum. Islamic texts have reported how after claiming the throne, her co-ruler, known only by the title of Habani, was forced into exile in Showa, where he died in 970 AD. Other sources that mention the queen include a letter sent by the last Aksumite king to church officials in Alexandria, Egypt, that pleaded in vain for their intercession. Honestly, Queen Gudi is an enigma because we know so little about her, but her impact on Ethiopian history is huge. The fact that one queen could have so much influence and power to change the course of an ancient Ethiopian empire is nothing short of exceptional. Our next African ruler is Queen Nzinga of Angola. Queen Nzinga was an African queen of the 17th century during a time when the Portuguese were trying to gain control of the region of Angola. Queen Nzinga is remembered as a great diplomat and warrior. During her reign, the Portuguese could not get a stronghold over the region, and it is this reason why Queen Nzinga should always be remembered. Nzinga brilliantly played on African and European politics to position herself in power. She formed alliances with the Dutch to counter Portuguese influence, and she installed herself as singular regent on the thrones of Ndongo and Matamba. Portuguese alliance with other Africans in the region posed serious problems for Queen Nzinga, but ultimately they were unable to meet their objectives as long as she lived. How she was able to survive the threats of African and European powers was quite impressive, serving as a model example for the diaspora today. Because of her accomplishments, a statue of her stands tall in Angola today. Next, we have Queen Tiye of ancient Egypt. Queen Tiye was the wife of Amenhotep III in the 14th century BC. Even though she did not reign exclusively or independently, she makes my list because she did hold considerable power during her husband's reign. Queen Tiye is celebrated for her intelligence and work ethic. She was well aware of the socio-political needs of Egypt, and she held administrative functions to aid Amenhotep III in his rule. Queen Tiye sometimes instructed imperial affairs and directed royal officials. The fact that she was mentioned by foreign rulers in correspondence says a lot about her agency in Africa and abroad. As an honorable mention, I wanted to acknowledge Hatshepsut of Egypt. Hatshepsut is an interesting case because technically, during the latter end of her rule, she wasn't acknowledged as a queen, but a king or pharaoh. Ultimately, it just depends on how you would like to define things, but she promoted herself more as a pharaoh and had a great legacy. Some argue that she was one of the greatest rulers in Egyptian history, male or female. Next, we have a little known queen from West Africa named Queen Yanu. Queen Yanu was said to have existed during the time of Sunni Ali in the 15th century. Sunni Ali was arguably the greatest conqueror king of West Africa, and not many people know he had a brief skirmish with a ruler known as Yanu. Queen Yanu is said to have established herself in the mountains between Hombori and Danaka in resistance to the great Sunni Ali. The great Songhai ruler forced her to flight as he was able to capture her niece named Jata. After Sunni Ali died, Yanu is said to have re-emerged as a great ruler. The queen was known to have been a capable leader and had a dedicated group of followers. Yanu's political and military prowess were on full display when the Barakoi Mansa Musa asked for her help in putting down a revolt led by one Mindi Jam, an iron worker. At the head of some 50 cavalry, Yanu led the charge, defeating and killing Mindi Jam, after which she established the town of Buyo on choice land in Bara province, the condition for her assistance. Queen Yanu is perhaps the most unknown and forgotten queen in all of African history. She faced a great force in Sunni Ali, and with a little courage, persistence, and perhaps some luck, she outlasted the great conqueror, becoming a sort of legendary figure in West African history. And last but not least, the greatest queen in African history, in my opinion, is Queen Amonarenes. If you've been watching my channel for a while, you know I take every opportunity I can to speak about her. Rome's interaction with the world through conquest or invasion is a popular topic, and Cleopatra's interaction with Rome is also a topic of interest. However, we neglect one of the most significant moments in African history when we fail to mention Queen Amonarenes and her interaction with Rome. Around 27 BC, Queen Amanerinus had a brief military skirmish in which she invaded Roman Egypt. The head of a statue in the form of Augustus was taken off by her in contempt of this bitter encounter. Rome sought to counter the Kushite queen, but finding difficulty navigating Nubian terrain, the Romans were stymied and did not engage further. Thus, a final battle never actually occurred, in which Amanerinus may have been expecting and prepared for. She kept record of everything in Meroitic script, but unfortunately, we can't fully decipher it. But we do know she ended up securing a very favorable treaty with Rome, which granted the queen all her desires. There has been no other monarch in Africa that took on such a great threat in the ancient world, going on to successfully safeguard the integrity of their borders, like Queen Amanerinus of Kush. And this is what makes her an exceptional African queen. Well, I'm all out, guys. If you like these videos and want to help in its continued production, consider supporting the home team on patreon.com. The link is in the description box below. Know thyself. Remember your ancestors. Peace.